فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. This is our second lesson in the explanation of خلاصة, a summary in مقدمة في أصول التفسير written by شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى. We finished how many chapters? We've done 2 chapters. And so today, inshallah ta'ala, this is going to be the 3rd chapter, بإذن الله الكريم.
فصل في نوعي الاختلاف في التفسير المستند إلى النقل وإلى طريق الاستدلال. الاختلاف في التفسير على نوعين، منه ما مستنده النقل فقط، ومنه ما يعلم بغير ذلك، إذ العلم إما نقل مصدق وإما استدلال محقق، والمنقول إما عن المعصوم وإما عن غير المعصوم، والمقصود بأن جنس المنقول سواء كان عن المعصوم أو غير المعصوم، وهذا هو النوع الأول. فمنه ما يمكن معرفة الصحيح منه والضعيف، ومنه ما لا يمكن معرفة ذلك فيه، وما نقل في ذلك عن بعض الصحابة نقلا صحيحا فالنفس إليه أسكن مما نقل عن بعض التابعين، لأن احتمال أن يكون سمعه من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أو من بعض من سمعه منه أقوى، ولأن نقل الصحابة عن أهل الكتاب أقل من نقل التابعين، ومع جزم الصاحب بما يقوله كيف يقال إنه أخذه عن أهل الكتاب وقد نهوا عن تصديقهم. وأما النوع الثاني من مستندي الاختلاف، وهو ما يعلم بالاستدلال لا بالنقل، فهذا أكثر ما فيه الخطأ من جهتين حدثتا بعد التفسير الصحابة والتابعين وتابعيهم بإحسان. إحداهما قوم معتقدوا معاني ثم أرادوا حمل ألفاظ القرآن عليها، والثانية قوم فسروا القرآن بمجرد ما يسوغ أن يريده بكلامه من كان من الناطقين بلغة العرب من غير نظر. أن يريده بكلامه من كان من الناطقين بلغة العرب من غير نظر إلى المتكلم بالقرآن والمنزل عليه والمخاطب به. فالأولون راعوا المعنى الذي رأوه من غير نظر إلى ما تستحقه ألفاظ القرآن من الدلالة والبيان والآخرون راعوا مجرد اللفظ وما يجوز عندهم أن يريد به العربي من غير نظر إلى ما يصلح للمتكلم به وسياق الكلام. ثم هؤلاء كثيرا ما يغلطون في احتمال اللفظ لذلك المعنى في اللغة، كما يغلط في ذلك الذين قبلهم، كما أن الأولين كثيرا ما يغلطون في صحة المعنى على الذي فسروا به القرآن، كما يغلط في ذلك الآخرون. وإن كان نظر الأولين إلى المعنى أسبق، ونظر الآخرين إلى اللفظ أسبق. والأولون صنفان، تارة يسلبون لفظ القرآن وما يسلبون، تارة يسلبون لفظ القرآن وما دل عليه وأريد به، وتارة يحملونه على ما لم يدل عليه ولم يدل عليه ولم يرد به. وفي كلا الأمرين قد يكون ما قصدوا نفيه أو إثباته من المعنى باطلا، فيكون خطأهم في الدليل والمدلول، وقد يكون حقا فيكون خطأهم في الدليل لا في المدلول.
Chapter: The two categories of differences in the exegesis of the Quran relating to the source, narrations and deductions. Difference in the exegesis can be of two types. The source of the first is narrations, and the other type is derived from different means. For knowledge is either a truthful narration or a correct deduction, and the narrations either originate from one who is infallible or one who is not. Here we will discuss these narrations irrespective of whether they stem from an infallible authority or not. This is the first category. At times we are able to distinguish between authentic and weak narrations, and at times we are unable to do so. Rather, authentic narrations from the companions in this regard are more reliable than narrations from their students, as it is stronger possibility that the companion heard his opinion from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or from another of the companions who in turn heard it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Furthermore, the companions' narrations from the people of the book are less than that of the tabi'un. Therefore, when a companion adamantly holds an opinion, it is not thought that he has taken this opinion from the people of the book, especially since they were forbidden from believing them. The second of the two categories in which difference occurs relates to reasoning and deduction as opposed to narration. Most mistakes which occur in tafsir are as a result of two things which appeared after the generation of the companions, their students, the tabi'un, and those who followed them in righteousness. The first problem which arose was people believing in certain ideologies and then interpreting the Quran to fit those ideologies. The second problem was a group of people who interpreted the Quran just as an average Arabic speaker would, without considering from whom these words came, to whom it was revealed, and who they were addressing. The first group concentrated on meanings that suited them without paying any attention to the real implication and context of the verses. The second group concentrated on the words and how they were used by the Arabs and disregarded the context of the verses. This group also mistakenly interprets words of the Arabic language, thinking that their interpretations are linguistically correct. The first group also falls into this error, but more so their error is that they are incorrect in the interpretations they give to the meanings of the Quran. The other group is also guilty of this. The first group prefers to concentrate on meanings, and the other group places emphasis on words. The first group is further divided into two subgroups: a group which strips the word of the Quran of their real and intended meaning, and a group which gives the words meaning which they do not convey. In both instances, that which they wish to affirm or negate may be incorrect, and therefore they have erred in both the evidence and the ideology they wish to support with it. Or that particular idea may be correct, in which case they have only erred in the way they use the evidences.
Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he chaptered here, and in his chapter, he speaks about asbab al-ikhtilaf, the reasons for disagreements. And he clarifies, rahimahullah ta'ala, that the asbab that necessitate, التي أوجبت الاختلاف في التفسير, that necessitated differences in tafsir, جماع الأسباب, all of it comes back to whether it be اختلاف amongst the Salaf or whether it be اختلاف amongst the متأخرين, the latecomers, all of them go back to two types. جماع الأسباب التي أوجبت اختلاف المفسرين, the scholars of exegesis, their خلاف only goes back to two things. Whether it be قديماً وحديثاً, it doesn't matter. The first one is أسباب تتعلق بالنقل, reasons that are related to al-naql, narrations. So there's the khilaf really is regarding narration. And the second one is asbabun, reasons tata'allaqu, that is related to bil-aql, intellect and rationality. And that is what the author mentions as the deductive evidences. So the khilaf is two. It is narration related and also deduction related. That's what this chapter and the heading which the author rahimahullah gave. And that, as we said, is the jima'ul asbab. It is the underlining reason of why there is disagreement amongst the scholars of tafsir. Now,
difference in the exegesis can be of two types. The source of the first is narrations, and the other type is derived from different means. For knowledge is either a truthful narration or a correct deduction, and the narrations either originate from one who is infallible or one who is not. Here we will discuss these narrations irrespective of whether they stem from an infallible authority or not. This is the first category. At times we are able to distinguish between authentic and weak narrations, and at times we are unable to do so.
الاختلاف في التفسير على نوعين، منه ما مستنده النقل فقط، ومنه ما يعلم بغير ذلك، إذ العلم إما نقل مصدق وإما استدلال محقق، والمنقول إما عن المعصوم وإما عن غير المعصوم، والمقصود بأن جنس المنقول سواء كان عن المعصوم أو غير المعصوم، وهذا هو النوع الأول، فمنه ما يمكن معرفة الصحيح منه والضعيف، ومنه ما لا يمكن معرفة ذلك فيه.
نعم. So here the Sheikh rahimahullah states, he says الاختلاف في التفسير على نوعين. The اختلاف in تفسير are two types. منه ما مستنده النقل فقط. One is that which goes back to ما يرجع إلى النقل. It goes back to narration فقط only. ومنه ما يعلم بغير ذلك. And the second one is that which is known other than that. What is, does he mean by other than that? He means بطريق العقل استدلالا واستنباطا. He means deduction. It is known by deduction. Then the author rahimahullah, he went towards to clarify the اختلاف of النقل. The اختلاف of النقل and the اختلاف of العقل أما استنباط استدلال. He mentions that the علم, the knowledge, this is a حصر, exclusivity. The Sheikh is trying to do what is known as حصر, and that it means فالعلم, that knowledge cannot be, it can't be unless it's from two angles. إما نقل مصدق وإما استدلال محقق. The first one is narration, and the second one is deduction. No other way can a knowledge be established. And that's two different sciences that we always say that the student of knowledge needs to study. The one that deals with an-naql, narrations, are science of hadith. Science of mustalah al-hadith, ilm al-rijal. All of those, they deal with what? Ilm al-naql. Are you with me? That, which is known as ilm al-riwaya. The second one is called ilm al-diraya. Diraya here is what? Usul al-fiqh. The person studies usul al-fiqh, which in which they learn dalalat al-alfaz and etc. So the first one is to establish the evidence that you're using. And then after that is, once you've established the evidence that you're using is authentic, you have to make sure what? That the way you're trying to extract the ruling out of it is correctly. That the way you're trying to extract the ruling is correctly. Then the author rahimahullah explains to us that the manqul, the things that are transmitted to us, are of two types. Imma am ma'sumin, it's either transmitted to us from a ma'sum, an infallible. And we said this usage of this word ma'sum is it's a strange usage. And it is a usage that we don't find in the Quran and the Sunnah, in the way that they are trying to use it, or the way it's being used. We have it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet, Ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu balligh ma ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu balligh ma unzila ilayka min rabbik wa illam taf'al fama ballaghta risalatahu wallahu ya'simuka min an-nas. And we said that doesn't mean what they're trying to say here. Wallahu ya'simuka min an-nas means Allah is going to protect you. Yahfaduka min an-nas. But here what they mean when they Sheikh Islam Taymiyyah and others, when they use the word ma'sum, is they mean he is infallible and he is far from al-khalal, deficiency in what he is conveying. But what we find that the Nusus use is, instead of the word usma, the Sharia, what does it use? It uses the word as-sidq, as-sadiq al-mazduq. Sah? When Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, Haddathana as-sadiq al-mazduq. As-sadiq al-mazduq. The man as-sadiq al-mazduq, the one who is truthful, and he's taken as a trustworthy one. So sidq is better to use, since that is the word that the Sharia, that the Nusus al-Kitab wa-Sunnah have used. Even himself, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, mentions that this usage has come from the Mu'tazila in his book Kitab al-Nubuwat. Ibn Taymiyyah himself, in his book Kitab al-Nubuwat, he clarifies that this word, ma'asum, is come from the Mu'tazila, and they're the ones who used it. So words like that, is best to avoid them and not to use it. And use what you can find from the Kitab and the Sunnah. But the Shaykh says here, إِمَّا عَنِ الْمَعْصُومِ وَإِمَّا عَنْ غَيْرِ الْمَعْصُومِ. So even the manqul, that which is transmitted to us, is of two types. That which is عَنِ الْمَعْصُومِ, from the Prophet عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ وَسَلَامُ. Are you with me? وَإِمَّا عَنْ غَيْرِ الْمَعْصُومِ. Are you with me? And that which is not from the غَيْرِ الْمَعْصُومِ. Who is it from not غَيْرِ الْمَعْصُومِ? It can be companions and other than them. It can be the companions and other than them. مِنَ التَّابِعِينَ and تَابِعُ التَّابِعِينَ. Then the Shaykh rahimahullah clarified that the jinsun naqli, the naql itself, which whether it comes from the ma'asum or whether it comes from an ghayri al-ma'asum, whether it comes from the ma'asum or ghayri al-ma'asum, and we explain what ma'asum and ghayri al-ma'asum means. It means they don't do mistake in what they convey, or they do mistake in that which they convey. He says, minhu ma yumkinu ma'rifatu sahihi minhu. Some of it, we're able to find whether it's authentic or not. والضعيف ومنهم ما لا يمكن معرفة ذلك. And there are some which we can't find out. Some of them we can find whether they're authentic, and whether it's true we can find out. And some we can't find out. Like for example, the dog of the Ahlul Kahf. What dog was it? What particular dog was it? We can't find out. Nabiullah Nuh, when the flooding came, the water that flooded the earth, what type of water was it? Was it water, was milhun ujaj? Was it salty water? Was it? We don't know this. Nabiullah Nuh, the Ashabul Kahfi, the ones in the cave, the dog that was with them, was it a bulldog? Was it a German shepherd? Was it a chihuahua? Man harifu. We don't know which one it is. This is something we can't weaken, nor can we authenticate. And it's from the things that the people find out through the books of Israeliyat. They try to find it from there in order to believe it or not. Nah.
Rather, authentic narrations from the companions in this regard are more reliable than narrations from their students, as it is a stronger possibility that the companion heard his opinion from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or from another of the companions, who in turn heard it from the Prophet alaihi salatu wasallam. Furthermore, the companions' narrations from the people of the book are less than that of the tabi'un. Therefore, when a companion adamantly holds an opinion, it is not thought that he has taken this opinion from the people of the book, especially since they were forbidden from believing them.
وما نقل في ذلك عن بعض الصحابة نقلا صحيحا فالنفس إليه أسكن مما نقل عن بعض التابعين لأن احتمال أن يكون سمعه من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أو من بعض من سمعه منه أقوى ولأن نقل الصحابة عن أهل الكتاب أقل من نقل التابعين ومع جزم الصاحب بما يقوله كيف يقال إنه أخذه عن أهل الكتاب وقد نهوا عن تصديقهم.
Now the Shaykh rahimahullah, by the way, I didn't mention at the beginning, but this chapter, the Shaykh rahimahullah, he brings 6 points. So we're now on the second one. We finished the first point, we're now moving on to the second one. And that is, the Shaykh Rahimahullah mentions, وَنُقِلَ فِي ذَلِكَ عَنْ بَعْضِ الصُّحَابَةِ نَقْلًا صَحِيحًا. Also, it has been transmitted to us authentically from the companions some narrations. فَالنَّفْسُ إِلَيْهِ أَسْكَنَ. Those narrations that have come to us from the companions, we find more tranquility and more relief. مِمَّا نُقِلَ عَنْ بَعْضِ التَّابِعِينَ. Than that which has been transmitted to us from the tabi'een, which are the students of the companions. Meaning the narrations of the sahabas have more weight in our eyes than the narrations that have come to us from the tabi'een. لِمَاذَا لِأَنَّ الْإِحْتِمَالَ أَنْ يَكُونَ سَمِعَهُ. Because there's a possibility that the companions have heard it from the messenger عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ والسلام. That's the first reason. The second reason is أَوْ مِنْ بَعْضِ مَنْ سَمِعَ مِنْهُ أَقْوَى وَلِأَنَّ النَّقْلَ الصَّحَابَةَ عَنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ أَقَلُّ مِنَ النَّقْلِ تَابِعِينَ. The second reason is because the Sahabas, their narration from the people of the book is less in number than the Tabi'een's transmission of the narrations of the people of the book. So for two reasons, Shaykh Rahimahullah, he strengthened the narrations that have come to us from the Sahabas. The first one is احتمال أن يكون سمعه من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أو من بعض ممن سمعه منهم. The Sahabas have either heard it from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, or they heard it from a companion who heard it from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The second reason is because أن لفظ الصحابة, that the Sahabas taking نقل الصحابة عن أهل الكتاب أقل من النقل التابعين. The second reason is because the Sahabas, them narrating from Ahlul Kitab is very little in number. In comparison to who? In comparison to the Tabi'een. Because the Tabi'een, they narrated more from Ahlul Kitab. They narrated more from Ahlul Kitab. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah rahimahullah, he has a kalamun nafis. He has a very powerful speech in his kitab, I'lamul Muwaqqi'in. He has a powerful speech which he strengthens, and he says, إِنَّ التَّفْسِيرَ الصَّحَابِيُّ لَهُ حُكْمُ الرَّفْعِ. That the commentary of a Sahabi on a verse has the ruling of Rafa. If a Sahabi comments on a verse, we're going to give it حُكْمُ الرَّفْعِ. And he strengthens that opinion. Because his argument is أَنَّ الصَّحَابَةَ لَمْ يَأْخُذُ عِلْمَ التَّفْسِيرِ. That the Sahabas did not take عِلْمُ التَّفْسِيرِ from them own selves. Who did they take it from? They took it from the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. They took it from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. ولذلك, that's why العراقي says وما أتى عن صحاب بحيث لا يقال رأيا حكمه الرفع على ما قال في المحصول النحو من أتى فالحاكم الرفع لهذا أثبتا. And that statement of العراقي رحمه الله, it seems like he's kind of, he spoke a bit unrestricted, meaning his speech is unrestricted. It's best to restrict it. ولذلك الشيخ صالح العصيمي حفظه الله, he restricted the statement of الإمام العراقي, and he said لكن ما أطلقه العراقي مقيد بالشبه الاتفاق بكون صاحب له لا يعرف أخذ له عن الكتاب فعرفوه. The صحابي, we can't give him حكم الرفع unrestricted like that. Because from within them is a noble companion who was very famous, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, who the day of Yarmouk, he had zamilataini. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, the day of Yarmouk, he had two big baskets, and he filled them up with those two big baskets, the books of the people of the Christians and the Jews. He filled it up, the book of, the scripture of the people of the books. He filled it up there. So his narration sometimes may not come from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam when he comments on an ayah. Where may he have brought it from? He might have looked at it and taken it from the book, the people of the books. He might have taken it from them. So this unrestricted right that the Sahabi statement is always lahu hukm al-raf'i is correct. If we say, as Sheikh Salih al-Usaymi says, لَكِنَّ مَا أَطْلَقَهُ الْعِرَاقِيُّ مُقَيَّدٌ بِشِبْهِ الْإِتِفَاقِ بِكَوْنِ صَاحِبِ لَهُ لَا يُعْرَفُ. He's not known. أَخْذُ لَهُ عَنِ الْكِتَابِ فَعْرِفُ. He's known not to take from who? The people of the book. He's known. And by the way, the Sahabas who did that were نَزْرٌ يَسِيرٌ. They were very little, few. They were not known to do that. they were not known to take from the people of the books. Rather, some of them just said it was Abdullah ibn Amr al-As only. Some of the scholars actually said it was only Abdullah ibn Amr al-As. He's the only exception in this principle. The rest of the Sahabas, all of them, they did not take from the people of the books. Whereas that if you look at the people of what? If you look at the Tabi'in, it's more in number. It's more in number. So now one may ask you, which one does the heart and the mind find more tranquility in his tafsir? We'll say the Sahabi. What's the reason? Because of those two reasons which we mentioned. Because of the two reasons we mentioned. Now we've finished the second point. Now we're going to move on to the third. Now,
the second of the two categories in which differences occur relates to reasoning and deduction as opposed to narration. Most mistakes which occur in tafsir are as a result of two things which appeared after the generation of the companions, their students, and those who followed them in righteousness.
وأما النوع الثاني من مستندي الاختلاف وهو ما يعلم بالاستدلال لا بالنقل فهذا أكثر ما فيه الخطأ من جهتين حدثتا بعد تفسير الصحابة والتابعين وتابعيهم بإحسان.
Now we finished the first point of the two reasons why the اختلاف of the مفسرين occur, right? The first one was what? النقل. The transmission, right? We spoke about the types of naql there was. Imma naqlun musaddaq. Sah. And then when we talked about the naql, we said imma an ma'asumin wa imma an ghayri ma'asumin. We also said that the naql of the sahabas has more power and more strength in our eyes than the naql that has come to us from the tabi'in. And we spoke about why Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, there are two reasons he gave for that. Sahih. Now we're moving on to the next ikhtilaf where it comes from. Asbabu tata'allaku bil'aqli. وهي المستندة إلى الرأي والنظر deduction. We're moving on to the next reason why the اختلاف happens. Okay, that's what the Sheikh says. أن النوع الثاني, the second type, من مستندي الاختلاف, the sources of اختلاف where it happens. And this is the second type, meaning يعني بطريق العقل للنقل. Don't think it's the narration. Okay, it's the deduction we're talking about. And Sheikh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah tells us that this is where the biggest اختلاف occurs. فهذا أكثر ما فيه الاختلاف. The اختلاف. فهذا أكثر ما فيه الخطأ من جهتين حدثتا بعد التفسير الصحابة والتابعين وتابعيهم بإحسان. This is the one that has the most number where the خلاف comes from, which is the issue of deduction. The majority of times is the issue of deduction. Good. Are you with me? And the second reason is that there are two main factors. That cause this to happen, that the deduction goes wrong. Are you with me? There are two main reasons why the deduction of those who try to deduce a ruling from understanding from it, there are two reasons why this happens to them. So now here the author goes into it. Now what we're going to do is the fourth and the fifth point. If you can read both of them together. And if you can read the fourth and the fifth, so we can just take that one together instead of having to bring you both back. Naam.